Hey, I want to welcome you here. I want you to look at the person beside of you and high five them and say, good job coming to church. Go ahead and do that right now. And you look back at that person that high fives you and say, I'm glad to see you in church because you need it. Go ahead and do that. Yeah, you need it. That's right. Yeah, we all need it. Hey, my name is Dale. I'm the lead pastor here at Stanley Chapel and Life Springs Church. And we want to welcome everybody in this auditorium, all those that are at Life Springs, all those that are in the lounge, all those in the party room, all those who tune in online. And I want everybody to let's give our Heavenly Father a hand clap of praise right now. Amen. Amen. We're excited about him saving our soul. And I apologize up front for my voice. I've been wearing my voice out for 20-some years preaching. I started preaching when I was a senior in high school, and it has now caught up with me. And I've got to the place where I don't even sing. I used to sing top of my lungs, and they're probably all glad that I don't do that no more. I don't know. I didn't sing well, but I sung loud. And I've been in a conference this week, and they had us yelling, and I yelled one time, and now I'm suffering for it. But anyway, so I apologize up front for that. Maybe it'll make me preach less time, but I don't think so. All right, there you go. It'll be there. So, hey, if you don't know Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, why don't you sit back, relax, enjoy yourself. It's not a members only club. You don't have to believe like us to come to church here. It's nothing like that. Nobody's going to single you out. We do believe the Bible to be 100% true. We believe that God reveals himself in the Bible, and we teach the Bible, and we believe that Jesus is the answer for not only life, it's the answer for death, and not only death, but he's the answer for eternal life. And so we have staked our whole being in the fact that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and he died on a cross for our sins, and now we can have a relationship with God through him. And we've staked it all in that. We built this building to tell people about that, and we pay money for that and make sure our kids know that. And so that's what this whole place is about. So you just sit back, relax, but we don't expect you to believe that until you come to that place in your faith. But if you do put your faith in Jesus during the service, maybe you already have and at Life Springs or wherever in the lounge or in here, and somewhere before this time in the service, you just felt you and God kind of got synced up. Like y'all, you just got like the connection was made, man. And all of a sudden you felt something happen inside of you. Then I want you to let me know about it so we can pray for you and so that I can somebody will reach out to you. If you don't want anybody reaching out to us, just don't give you your contact information. Don't put your phone number or address or anything on there. But at least put your name and put the box that says, I just committed or recommitted or established or reestablished a relationship with Jesus Christ. And so I can cover you in prayer at the very least. So I can cover you in prayer. And we're very excited about you being here and excited about helping people make that journey of faith. We've set a goal this year. We want 366 people make a commitment to Christ. And I know it's over 110 now. I think it's somewhere around 113 or 14 people so far this year who have made a commitment to Jesus Christ. We're actually ahead of the days right now. Amen. Amen. I know we're about 3 or 4 ahead of the number we're supposed to be. So let's keep speaking life over that. Let's keep speaking life over that, and let's keep bringing our lost friends. And if you're not inviting somebody, shame on you. All right, you need to be inviting somebody every single week to come so they can make a commitment to Jesus Christ. Now we've been in a series, and if you look inside of your bulletin, there's some sermon notes there. I want you to follow along and follow along with us. We're in a series, and we're winding it up this week, and it's been called 1, 2, 3. What's it called? Life. And today what I want to talk to you about is building an atmosphere of life, creating an atmosphere and a dynamic and a place for things to grow, because you can have a greenhouse or you can have what do you call those things wherever you put stuff in it and they rot and decay to use for fertilizer, right? You know what I'm talking about? What is it called? Compost, right? You could have compost or greenhouse. You know, you want to have an atmosphere of death or an atmosphere of life. And I want to talk to you about building your life and creating an atmosphere of life. So as we get into this, let's all participate. If you're able to speak out loud, let me hear you say yes. Yes. If you're not ashamed to speak out loud in church, would everybody say yes? Yes. So let's go. Ready? I want you to do this for me. Say roast 5 times. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Roast, 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 roast. Let's do it again. I don't think Life Springs did it. Ready? One more time. Ready? Roast, 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 roast. Now, what do you put in a toaster? Toast. No, you don't. You put bread. Let's try it again. Ready? Say silk 5 times. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Silk, silk, silk. Y'all quiet or come on? Don't be worried on me. Don't be backing out on me. Come on. Everybody online, we're ready. One, two, three. Silk, 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 silk. Come on again. Silk, 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 silk. What does a cow drink? No, they drink water. There you go. Y'all are. Now let me tell you what's going on here. What that is, it's a momentum, okay? And sometimes when you get momentum going in a direction, it's hard to stop it when it's going in that direction. See, I know because I've been this same size since third grade. Now, you get this much man swaying in one direction, I'm going over, baby. You understand what I'm saying? Because this fuss fat going in one way, there ain't no way to stop it. You understand, right? It's the power of momentum. It's how it swing you right or swing you wrong. Now, here's the great thing about momentum and the power of that direction is if you get into a direction of going right, then it swings you in a right direction, right? That's the whole thing. When these people who swing on, swings, tree swings or whatever, you know, and high ropes and all those things, they can swing in those areas, you know, cable rides and those, they can swing. Like, or if you get it going in the wrong direction, you ever started to fall, know you're falling, but can't stop it. Somebody say amen, right? You see, the same thing's true whenever I used to train horses, and what I would do is somebody couldn't put a saddle on a horse. So, you know, they couldn't ride it, obviously, because they couldn't put a saddle on a horse. So what we do is we keep breaking it down to where they would say yes. So I start out by putting my hand on the horse. If they'd let my hand be on the horse, then I might take a handkerchief and put a handkerchief on a horse. And then I might take a coat and put on a horse. And then I'll put a blanket on a horse. And we just get them in a rhythm of saying, it won't go in a horse trailer. Let's don't try to go in a horse trailer. Will you just come follow me and lead? And will you take one step when I ask you to take one step? And we just break it down, because if I can get that horse in a pattern of saying yes instead of in a pattern of saying no, I'm more apt to get him moving in the right direction. I've learned the same thing with my kids. Come on, all the parents. If I get them in a pattern of saying no, in a pattern of resistance, in a pattern of not wanting to do it, the whole atmosphere of the house has changed. But let me tell you, I learned it before my kids. Come on, and I'm going to talk to teenagers for a minute. And you don't amen me, teenager, because this gets you in trouble. But you know it's the truth. You do the same thing with your parents. You work them over, don't you? You get them in a pattern of saying yes, you know, right? And then before long, you slip one right in on them right there, and they don't even know it, right? But see, if you get them in a pattern of saying no, then you know that's a problem, because see, there's a pattern, and those patterns begin to dictate where we're going and what's happening. I've learned the same thing, and I could keep going. I've learned the same thing in church. I coach pastors from all over the nation, and they're trying to make changes in their church, and we got to get in a pattern of saying yes, because when you can build a culture that says yes, then you can bring change. Now, here's what I've also learned. The same thing's true in our life spiritually. Have you ever noticed that if you tell a lie and you say no to God in that area, it's much easier to sin in other areas of your life? Have you noticed that? Have you ever noticed that if you are in an area where you say no to God when it comes to some area, maybe, I don't know, tithing or maybe your thought life or a movie, you should, whenever you start in a pattern to say no, you start missing one Sunday. Have you noticed, come on, let's take a poll right here. Everybody here in Life Springs, wherever else, on the lounge, ready? Have you noticed that it's easier when you miss one Sunday, it makes it easier to miss two? Come on, anybody hold your hands up, right? How many of you noticed when you tell one lie, it's easier to tell two? It makes it easier on that second one. Hold your hands up good. Now, some of you like, I ain't raising my hand to tell them I've lied, right? Don't act holy. We already know you lying because you ain't raised your hand. You know, right? Yeah, it's just a pattern when you get in that pattern. But here's the deal. When you start saying yes to God, when you start getting in a place in your life where you're saying yes to God, then it's like whenever he asks you to do this and your answer is yes, Lord. And then he asks you to do something else, your answer is yes, Lord. And your answer is yes, Lord. And when you start saying yes, Lord, it produces a better what? Life. And you know that. And so I want to talk to you about that. So here we go. Ready with your Stanley Chapel Life Spring Search social media moment. Go ahead and put this in your blank if you're taking notes, and tweet it and post it and let everybody know about it. Ready? You can't create a move of God, but you can prepare for a move of God. You can't create a move of God. Some of you have been trying to create a move of God. You can't create a move of God in your life, but what you can do is prepare yourself for a move of God. And the way you prepare yourself for a move of God is by saying yes to God. So what I want to do during this message is actually I want to apply this message, and I never like sermons that try to aim at two targets, because I'm an old hunter. I grew up hunting and rabbit hunting, and I learned that if you try to aim at two things, you'll miss both of them. You know what I'm saying, right? And I'm going to violate my own rule here. I'm going to try to do it with some discipline. I want to apply this message on two levels. I want to apply it to us individually, and that's going to be my main focus, is that you will apply this message individually to your life. But occasionally, I want to drop in. I would like for us to apply this message corporately as a church. You see, here's what I want to have happen. I want individually, I want you to be at a place where you are, the hand of God is moving in your life. I'm hoping that at the end of this series that you're not going to be shocked when God begins to bless you. You're not going to be shocked when your life begins to get better, because you've chosen to get on a different road in life. And I want you to have a spirit and an atmosphere in your life that prepares for God to move. I want you to lead more people to Jesus next year than you did last year. I want you to be blessed financially and to give more money this year than you did last year. I want you to have a healthier marriage this year than you had. I want to see the hand of God move in the lives of the people of this church. Come on, somebody. Anybody else want that? If so, how many of you want to see God's hand in your life and your family? Hold your hands up good and high. I'm wanting that. I want to help prepare you for that. But not only that, I want this church to see the hand of God move like we've never seen the hand of God move before. I want to see God. I want to see more people saved here. I want to see more blessing here. I want to see more things happen here. I want to see that life that He's promised us happen here. And the only way, and this has always been a life-giving church. You ever been here? You already know. This is a life-giving church. We give a lot of things away. We have a lot of laughter. We have a lot of fun because we have a lot of love. And it's been like that since our founder, Earl and Della Norris, who are still in our church family. They come almost every week when health provides. They founded this church to be life-giving and just breathe the life into people, and not feel discouraged and feel worse about yourself after you come to church, but to feel better and have hope and have joy. And we want this to continue, but the only way that's going to continue as a church is if we've got that going on individually. Because I don't know if this ever dawned on you or not, but you are the church. Amen. I'm not the church by myself. This building is not the church. You or Stanley Chapel and Life Springs Church. Look at the person beside of you and say, you are the church. And that's telling them, say, you better start acting like it. Go ahead, yeah. Hey, all right, here. Now, here's what we've been talking about. Let me give you our two verses that we've been talking about this whole series on. And we've been basing this whole series on these two verses so you can get them. Ready? In John 10:10, it says, the thief comes to steal, only to steal and to kill and to destroy. That's the whole reason the devil has come into your life. That's what he wants to do, is to steal, kill, and destroy. And Jesus says, I have come that you might have 1, 2, 3. And have it to the full. He says, I've come. There's two forces in your life. One is trying to steal, kill, and destroy everything that you've got. Your joy, your peace, your health, your marriage, your kids, everything. There's the devil and all of his demons are after you. And it's not that you're paranoid. It's not that you're psycho. It's that, honestly, there's a war going on for your soul. And the devil wants your soul. But just like there's a real devil, there's a real God. Somebody say amen. And that real God has sent His Holy Spirit to work in your family's life. And He's drawing you to be good. And that's why you're here in this service. That's why you're watching online. That's why you are doing it. Because there's the Holy Spirit of God. Did you know you can't even pray unless the Holy Spirit of God is drawing you to pray? Because it's not even on your mind. You're not even thinking like that according to the Bible. And so the Holy Spirit of God is constantly working in your life, asking you to pray, asking you to read His Word, asking you to be in church, asking you to make better choices with your life, because there's a real war going on for your soul. And that's the reason Jesus told us. He said, listen, I want you to enter through the narrow gate. I want you to make the choice to go the right way, because most people won't. For wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to, ready, 1, 2, 3. And many enter through it. He says, but small is the gate and narrow is the road that leads to, ready, 1, 2, 3. And only a few find it. And so what I told you when we started this series on Easter is that I wanted to help you find it. I wanted to help you get on this narrow road. I wanted you to make a choice to get on this narrow road. How many of you believe, no head bow, all eyes open, How many of you believe in here, in the lounge, at Life Springs? How many of you believe you're making the choices right now in your life to get on the narrow road that's leading to life? Hold your hands up good and high. You believe you're making better choices right now than you used to make. Hold your hands up. Good. Good. Hold them up if you believe that, because we're going to celebrate it. Come on, let's celebrate that right now. Let's give ourselves, give God, give the Holy Spirit a hand. We're winning. We're winning. And that's what I'm devoting this whole year to, is winning and helping you win. And so that's the series before this, set us up for that, breaking the patterns. And now what I'm going to do in the next series, I'm going to give you about, I don't know how many is in this packet here, probably about seven or so, five of them. And I'm going to give you five invite cards. I'm going to talk to you about guardrails. Most popular, how many of you were here when we did guardrails before? If you were, yeah, several of you. Most popular series we've ever done in the history of ever. And it's a series by a famous pastor named Andy Stanley down in Alpharetta, Georgia. And we took it and just kind of, what I often say is we took their sausage and put it through our sausage grinder, and we come out with our own sausage, right? And so we took their material and we've done it. So we're going to repeat this series, and I want to tell you some disciplines. This is going to be real, you know, nuts and bolts. This is going to be real practical stuff, and it's the guardrails to keep us on the road of life, and that's what it's about, and some real disciplines that I've created in my life that have helped me walk this road that we're talking about. So you're going to get that on your way out. So the first week of this series, I told you that if you feel robbed, stripped, wounded, left for dead, good news. Jesus came so that you can have life, and he's paid your bill so he can restore you. Week two, I told you that this is not just about clean living. Something had to happen to you inside. You had to be born again. And so this whole thing about eternal life and this whole thing about the good life is going to flow from the inside out. Then week number three, I told you that you're going to have to quit looking on this wide road for satisfaction. You're going to have to quit getting colder. You got to get warmer, get closer to Jesus. Quit trying to quench your thirst with salt. You're going to have to quench your thirst with the living water of Jesus Christ. And then last week I talked to you about a foundation to build your life on so that it would not crumble, but that it would become the roadmap to guide you to life. And now this week I want to talk to you about the atmosphere that you have in your life, preparing the atmosphere so that you can experience life, so that you're in a station in your life where you can say yes to God, and that we can avoid the compost, but we can get into the greenhouse. Everybody with me? If so, say amen. Now, we're going to look at a story in Mark chapter 5, and I think the context of it's going to be clear in the verses that we're going to be reading. So here we go, Mark chapter 5, verse 21. When Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side, so he's going across the other side of the lake, he's going across the Lake of Galilee, and he's going across, and when he gets over there, by this point in his ministry, he's done a lot of miracles, a lot of people know who he is, he's a very, very popular dude. When he gets to the other side, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders, now that's very important that you understand that. In fact, if you're taking notes, and the verses should be there in your outline, circle synagogue leader. Because you've learned during this series that the synagogue leaders, and if you know anything about Bible stuff at all, were not real big Jesus fans. So there's a large crowd, a lot of people like Jesus, but the synagogue leaders didn't. And so this was a big step for him. This synagogue leader named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. This took a great amount of courage for Jairus, and he was a synagogue leader, and he was going against the grain to be able to do this. Now, this shows that really who he honestly thought about, what he honestly thought about Jesus. In fact, let me just tell you this, and what we're going to learn is the reason Jairus would push through and go against the grain and go against the tide is because he had a real desperate need in his life. Because, see, here's the deal. In the foxhole, it's hard to find an atheist. When you get a pain in your life, you know, it's hard. It's like the atheist, he went out fishing in this lake where they said the Loch Ness Monster lived. And he didn't believe in Loch Ness Monster, he didn't believe in God. He thought all that mess was silly. So he got out there and he was fishing, and all of a sudden the boat started there and he saw the back of that Loch Ness Monster swimming around him, and he got all scared. He's out in the middle of the lake and it's all coming around him, circling, and he cried out. He said, "God, help me." And he said, a voice from heaven came through and said, "I thought you didn't believe in me." He said, "I didn't believe in a Loch Ness Monster either. You know, help me," right? Because you see, sometimes you get in a situation in your life where you just cry out to God. And see, that's okay, because see, that's what Jesus wants. He wants to get you in a place where you're dependent upon him. And so he'll allow situations in your life that you'll have to trust him, because he wants to reveal himself to him. See, some of you's not sure about God, but here's what God said. Ready? If you seek, you will what? Yes, you will. He's not hiding from you. You just ain't been really seeking him. You've not been pursuing him. You've not wanted a relationship with him. And so the Bible says that, listen, when you get desperate, desperate people all of a sudden begin to do desperate things and you begin to cry out. And so listen, I want you to understand, this is what I want. I want to cry out to God before I'm desperate. Can anybody say amen to that? I don't want to wait till I got trouble in my marriage before I start building my marriage on Jesus Christ. I don't want to wait for I have trouble in my finances before I start building my finances on Jesus Christ. I don't want to wait till my kids are acting, you know, like their mama before I start raising them right, you know. I want to get proactive. Can anybody say amen to that, right? I want to get out in front of that, and I want to make sure I'm helping them get there. So this is where Jerry's at. He's falling at the feet because if you're honest, when you're seeking, you're honest, you'll find out who Jesus is. And he pleaded earnestly with him. And that's a typo. It's not H-M, it's H-I-M. But anyway, him. And he said, my little daughter is dying. Now, I'm telling you, nothing would drive me to Jesus than my little daughter dying. Can anybody say amen? He said, please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed, which I think is very interesting. You see, this guy is extremely desperate. Can I ask a question? Let's just all get on the same page. Anybody other than me ever been desperate for God to move in your life? Hold your hands up good and high if you ever. If you hadn't, you will. You will. And it's not just because things are bad, but if you've ever been in a place where you're desperate for God to do something, this man is desperate. Sometimes we're desperate because we're just hurting. Sometimes we're desperate because we're just wanting to see God move in our generation. I find myself desperate right now, actually, for God to move in our county in ways like we've never seen. But sometimes we're desperate because something's threatening things that we love. You got a bad report, and so now you got this cancer word in your family, and it makes you desperate, or your wife said she's leaving, and now you're desperate. But this is where this guy's at. He feels threatened, and because he feels threatened, he now is desperate. And so he says, Jesus, I want you to heal her, and I want you to come and lay your hands on her. And I think that's very interesting. He said, put your hands on her. Here, I just want to point this out, and I got to move on. Let me tell you, this is actually a sign that his faith was a little bit weak anyway, because let me tell you about Jesus. If you read the Bible, in fact, if you're doing a 21-day challenge, we read a story this week in here where he never even laid hands on people and they were healed. You see, Jesus didn't have to put his hands on his daughter to be healed. All he had to say is, be healed. Because he's Jesus, right? He didn't have to do it. But see, this guy thought, watch this, this is very important. I don't want you to miss this. I got to move on. This guy limited God to his ability and his mindset. Can I tell you what I find people do all the time? Limit God to what some preacher told them, what my mama told them, what they've always seen, what they've always known. Because we form these little theologies, we form these little ways of worshiping that we put God in a box and we want him to move and act the way we want him to move and act. And if he ever gets out, and we don't want to keep him in that box, because if God ever gets out of that box, then it's like he's in charge and we are not. And we like to keep God kind of under our thumb. And so we design these thought patterns and these systems to put God in a box. But let me tell you something. God is bigger than your box. You can't put God in a box. He's got options. See, you only think God can do three things. Right now, you're praying for something. You're desperate for something in your life. You're needing God to move financially. You're needing God to move in your marriage. You're needing something to happen with your kids. And you've given God three options. You've given him A, B, or C. But let me tell you what I know about God that you might not know. He's got options you ain't thought about. He's got O, P, Q, R, S, T. He's got options you don't even know about. Because he's God and you're not. And you can't put him in a box. So this is where this guy is. And so I just want to let you know, don't limit God by your own perception. And so what his faith could handle is what he said is, he said, I need you to put your hands on my daughter so she'll be healed. And Jesus didn't challenge his faith in him because he knew what's going to happen. So Jesus said, okay, I'll go with you. And a large crowd still follow him because he's a very popular dude. And so they're following him and he says, I'll go with you. And he's following the chariots to his house and this crowd's following him and they're pressing in around him. And I can imagine how Jairus is feeling. He he's like, wow, my daughter's not going to die, and I've gone against the grain. I'm so glad that I didn't listen to my contemporaries. I'm so glad I didn't bow to peer pressure. I'm so glad I didn't listen to my other synagogue leaders. I'm so glad I came to Jesus. I have hope. Have you ever had hope that God's going to do something for you? Anybody, if you have, say amen. Where you got this faith that God's going to do something, and you got this hope, and you got this belief, and it seems like God is moving in your direction. It seems like God is swaying in the direction you want him to go, and it's very exciting. But this ain't how it went for Jesus and for Jairus. What happened now is this crowd that followed Jesus, they got all up on him. And that was this woman with this issue of blood, and she touched his garment, and then Jesus got distracted by her and her healing and her story, and she was healed, and it just became, it's a great story, and it's a whole other sermon. I don't have time to say, but what this meant was he got tied up with this large crowd, and Jairus is over here waiting because his daughter's dying. Now, let me tell you what I've learned. You know, God didn't move in the time frame that Jairus thought he should move. And let me tell you what I've learned. I have learned, somebody say amen, if this is true, God is never late. Can anybody say amen?
Amen.
But I've also learned God is rarely early. Can anybody say amen to that? Amen. Have y'all ever noticed God's like in the nick of time, right? So he does that to stretch your faith. He does that to make you realize and to put your faith in him and not worry and not doubt and have trust. And this is exactly what's happening for Jairus. So we're going to skip down to verse 35. Jesus is distracted by that woman touching him and all this kind of stuff. And so while Jesus was still speaking, some of the people from the house of Jairus, of the synagogue leader, came and they said, your daughter is, 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
That's not an atmosphere of life. They said, why bother the teacher anymore? In other words, it's too late, man. It's too late. You don't need to bother him no more, Jesus. You might as well quit praying. This marriage is dead. You might as well quit praying. These finances are dead. You might as well give it up because it's over, Rover. He didn't show up in time. And now my dream's dead. And now my hope's dead, and now the thing that I have hoped for, this daughter, is dead. You ever had something die? Hopefully you've never had a kid die. I can't imagine the pain of that. Some of you have. I can't imagine the pain. But maybe you've had something else die that's very important to you. Maybe the dream of working, of having the marriage you always dreamed, and you've just given up on that. Maybe some of you feel dead inside. You just numb. But maybe some of you were called into a ministry in your younger years. You went to a youth camp. You were at a vacation Bible school. You were at a church, and you were close to God, and you had some pretty spectacular sins that came along, and you got pretty diverted, and you feel like that ship has sailed. That window of opportunity has closed. And now for the rest of my life, I'll have to settle for second best. Can I tell you that the word second best is never in the Bible anywhere? You ought to read it. God don't even know what that is. He's a God of grace and mercy. But for you, it's dead. It's dead. And maybe that's where you are right now. And I wanted to talk to you because good news is that we serve a God that specializes in resurrections. Can anybody say amen? And he will resurrect things in our life that we thought could never be resurrected, that we thought were dead. And so I want to talk to you a little bit about that. I want to talk to you about how to prepare the atmosphere for life. So let's get going. Ready? Preparing the atmosphere for life. Some things from this story. We're going to kind of break this story up now. I was just giving you the context. And now I want to break the story up. And I want to look at some things that Jesus did to prepare to bring a resurrection, to bring this thing from death to life, from compost to greenhouse. I want to tell you some things that you can do and how we can get those principles working in our life as well. So here we go. Preparing the atmosphere for life. Number one, discourage doubt and encourage faith. Very first thing you got to do is discourage doubt and encourage faith. Here we go. Ready? Mark chapter 5, verse 36. He said, overhearing what they said, Jesus said, he's been distracted with this woman touching him and all. They come up and said, Jairus, don't bother the teacher. Your daughter's already dead, man. And all of a sudden, he's crushed. This thing with hope. Jesus is coming. Jesus is moving in my direction. Everything seems to be going to splat. Now it seems like everything died. And Jesus hears that. And Jesus told him, he says, listen, look at Jairus. Look at me. Eyeball to eyeball, man. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Don't be afraid. just don't be afraid, just believe. The first key to revival, the first key to seeing a move of God in your life, the first key to preparing for God to bring life to you is that you have got to kick out the fear of the what ifs. What if? What if this is the end? What if this is true? What if people, what if I work on this marriage and they don't respond? What if people think I'm crazy for giving it this much? What if I give this money and I don't get my rent paid? What if I do this and they don't do that? What if I forgive this person for what they've done to me and then they do it again? What if I get become really sell out to Jesus and all my family thinks I'm a Jesus freak, one of them fanatics, right? What if I start doing this thing and my family kicks me out of the family because I start getting a different value? What if I sell out to Jesus and I have to give my life, I have to quit dating my boyfriend and really just sell out everything in my heart to Jesus and start dating different kinds of, what if I really become a giver and I have to, and people find out I'm buying my clothes at Walmart? We already know. We saw it too. We were going to buy it, but you already had it. So we got another color, you know. Here's the deal. Ready? Listen, the what ifs are going to kill you. You're going to have to get rid of the fear in your life, and you're going to have to start embracing faith. Now, let me be clear with what I'm saying. Now, we were watching the other night, my kids and I, the great theologian. I don't know if y'all have ever heard him or not, Andy Griffith. Y'all know who that is, right? And so Andy Griffith was in a situation where he was going to have to confront someone, and they thought the guy was going to kill him. And Opie said, he said, "Dad, aren't you scared?" Y'all remember Opie? Aren't you scared? You know, whatever. Anyway, he said, "Dad, aren't you scared?" You know, and he said, "Don't you have any fear?" And Andy Griffith, and it was one of them old ones. I mean, Andy's still smoking, you know, right? Calming his nerves, you know, whatever. Anyway, and Andy said, "Yeah, I'm scared, but I'm not letting this fear define me." And I just paused it because aren't you glad you're not my child, right? You know, teach an opportunity, right? And so I paused it and I talked to him. I said, "Listen, here's the deal, guys. When I tell you not to be afraid, I'm not telling you not to have the emotion of fear, because guess what? That's impossible. If I said don't be afraid, then you know what? That means I would never preach, because every time I preach, I'm afraid. It's not about you're not going to have the emotion of fear. But what it means is that fear's not going to dictate your actions. Can I teach you a principle right quick? And I don't have a lot of time, so you're going to have to listen real fast on this one. Ready? Because if you can get this one principle, this is going to help you. If you have a sexual temptation, if you have financial problems, you can't live on a budget, if you have problems with a fear and you can't, you got a gift to sing, but you can't stand up and sing because you're dominated by fear. If you can catch this one principle, it can help you in every area of your life. Ready? Watch this. Ready? God gave us emotions to be the caboose of our life, not the engine of our life. Okay, let me unpack that. Ready? See, what most people do is they let their feelings lead the way in what choices they make. I feel like I want to buy this, so I buy this. I feel like I fell in love, so I'm getting married. I feel like I fell out of love. That's amazing. Like, you can fall in love and fall out of love. How do you do that? Anyway, it's like you can fall out of love, and so now my feeling has left, and so now I'm getting a divorce, because the feelings are driving your choices. That is not the biblical model. Because you see, everything good in your life, if you wait till you feel like it, you'll never do it. Let me just prove it to you. How many of you can wake up at 5:00 in the morning and feel like working out? How many of you have ever worked out and after you were working out a while felt like working out? Hold your hands up, right? Your feeling came along. Why? So he's like, nah, you know, right? Yeah. Because you know why? Because watch this. Your feelings are the caboose to your choices. You make the choice, and then regardless of what you feel like, you make the choice, I'm going to love this person whether I feel like loving this person or not. Because love is not a feeling only, it's an action. And so I'm not going to get divorced. I'm going to start actually replacing that with forgiveness and kindness and peace. And I'm going to replace that with 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient, it is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast. I'm going to replace those actions. And let me tell you what I'm going to teach you about your marriage. Ready? If you will start acting in a loving way, the feeling of love will come back to your marriage. Because it's the caboose to your decisions. If you will make the decision, I'm going to get up and do. Fear is not going to dominate my life. I'm not going to stop. I'm not going to not be a giver. I'm not going to not live on a budget. I'm going to live on a budget. I'm going to be a giver. You make the decision of where your life wants to go, and I'm telling you, the feeling of generosity will come behind that. The feeling of wanting to have self-control in your spending will come behind it. Am I preaching? Do y'all understand this? If so, say amen. You need to quit letting feelings be the engine to your life. They need to be the caboose to your life. And you need to start running your life on decisions, not on feelings. Because feelings will lie to you. How many of you ever woke up and felt like a dream was real? You ever felt, you know, right? It felt real, didn't it? I mean, one time, I ain't lying. Yeah, I did this. I wish this weren't true. But y'all ain't listening fast enough. This thing, I guarantee you I'm off my notes right now. But I'm going to tell you this, okay? And other services can't get this because I ain't going to have time. Ready? So y'all listen real quick. I remember one time waking up in class. Screaming. I went, wah! True story. And the professor, the teacher was just, I was having one of them good, I'm talking, y'all know what I'm talking about, right? Some of y'all slept in class where you put your head down and you woke up and the spiral was on the cheek, you know, from the notebook, right? And you can, you can always judge the nap in class by the puddle left on the desk, you know? Come on, somebody, y'all know what I'm talking about right now, right? And so I had the whole, you could have fished in that pond, baby, you know, right? I had the whole thing going on there and the spiral going down. And I thought I was falling off a cliff, you know, right? I mean, I really did. Just interrupted the whole class. Because why? Your dreams can feel real, but feelings will lie to you. Feelings will lie to you. So if you're gonna have, see this, I'm way off subject here. Y'all come on back here now, ready? Don't be afraid, just believe. You've got to quit letting your fear keep you from believing. Somebody say amen. You got to put faith in God to get off that wide road and get it on this narrow road. You're going to have to replace the fear. See, some of you don't want to get off that wide road because you're scared you're going to have to break up with your boy. You're scared you're going to not have money. You're scared you're not going to. Listen, you're going to have faith if you want life. Don't be afraid, just what? You're going to have to believe. And not let fear keep you from getting on the right road. How many of you understand it? Makes sense to y'all? All right, number two. We can't take this much time on this one. All right, number two. Build the right team. Here we go. Ready? Build the right team. Get the right people around you. If you're going to have life, not compost, you're going to have to get the right people around you. Ready? He did not let anyone follow him except who? Peter, James, and John. That was the same three that saw the baptism, same three that saw the transfiguration, same three that he let be in the garden. This was his inner circle. This was the inner circle for Jesus. Jesus had the multitudes. Then he had 70 people that he released. That was kind of like his people. And then he had the 12 disciples. That was his close friends. But he had three really, really, really close friends, Peter, James, and John. And the brother of Jesus. James. So now here's the deal. Ready? This is very important because I want you to understand something. What he did is he got the right team, because when you have a healthy atmosphere, here's what happens with a healthy atmosphere. You don't need more people. You might need less people, because when you have the right atmosphere in your life, when you have the right culture in your life, you can do more with less. In fact, let me say this up front. You don't necessarily need more friends. You need the right friends. You don't necessarily need more people in your life. You need the right people in your life. You need the right people there. In fact, let me just say this about Jesus. He not only did this here, this was a principle for him. He did more with less. He did more with less education. These guys that he had around him, they didn't have big education. They want the synagogue leaders like Jairus. They want the guys who were real edumacated. They were people like you find at Walmart. They were fishermen. They were those kind of guys. And this is why, because he could do more with less. Jesus learned you could do more with less with money. Jesus didn't have a lot of money. The Bible says that birds have nests and foxes have holes, but the Son of Man had nowhere to lay his head. Now, see, there's a lot of people who have been very rich, filthy rich, that died, and we don't even know their name. But you know Mother Teresa's name, don't you? Because you know why? When you've got the right atmosphere in your life, it's not about having more money. It's not about more education. It's not about more friends. It's not about any of that. It's not about having more time. In fact, listen, watch this. Jesus only lived 33 years. It's not about having a whole lot of time. You see, the healthy atmosphere in your life, you can do more with less whenever you get the right atmosphere working for you. Because, see, the right atmosphere is going to promote unity. And I want to preach this on a church level so bad I can't stand it right now. But when you got the right people, then you got unity. See, he got Peter, James, and John there because he knew they were going to be going in the same direction he is. You ever seen two ox tied up to a cart? And this is why the Bible says in marriage, don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. And the same thing's true, not in just marriage. It don't say marriage. It says don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. So that means in a business contract, it means in a marriage, it means anything. Because when you got one ox and they're tied together and they're supposed to be pulling this cart, I'm the cart, and there's one ox wanting to go that way and one ox wanting to go that way, we ain't getting very far. But when both oxes can get beside each other and get going in the same direction, then all of a sudden now we've got movement and we got going in the right direction. You see, you don't necessarily need more people. You need people who's going to be going in the right direction as you're going. You need to get people in your life that are going to be aimed at the right direction, because a healthy atmosphere will promote unity. I tell you something else, a healthy atmosphere will promote faith in your life. You got people around you that don't believe, and then you get people around you who do believe, guess what's going to happen to your faith? When you get people around you who don't, it's kind of like the law of gravity. If I'm on top of a table and you're below, and you're trying, or back to say it the other way around, you're on top of a table and I'm below, and we're going to pull against each other, which one's going to happen? Am I going to pull you down or are you going to pull me up? Sweetheart, if you pull me up, you are the man. Because why? The law of gravity says most likely I'm going to pull you down. You start hanging out with people that don't have any faith, guess what's going to happen to your faith? But you start hanging around people that's got more faith, and all of a sudden you'll find yourself being elevated to it. Because why? It promotes faith whenever you've got the right atmosphere. That's the reason we have subdivided this church into small groups, because I want to get you in the right people in your life. Now, am I telling you everybody in groups the right people? Nope, but I'm telling you that there's a good chance you're going to find some right people there. Amen. I'm telling you, you need to get the right people, or if you want to have life and not death, if you want the greenhouse and not the compost, you're going to have to discourage doubt, encourage faith, and you're going to have to get the right people around you. I'm telling you, I am way better. When I was growing up in school, I had a reading disability and speech pathology problems. And now look at what I do for a living. Whenever I come here to pastor this church, my pastor told me, he said, the biggest problem with you, Dale, is I'm worried about your attention to detail. Because you don't want me to plan a trip for you. I can tell you that, right? But you know what? There's an incredible group of people around me. I have gone further, faster, because the right people are there. The same thing can happen for you. You got to get the right people in your life. How many of you, am I making sense? I understand, right? Now, ready? This feeds off of that. Ready? Number three. You got to prepare in the atmosphere for life. You got to discourage doubt and encourage faith. You got to build the right team. Now, number three, you got to separate from the negative atmosphere. Now, this one's huge. This, all of them are, but this one's huge. Now, I love this part of the story right here. So Jairus is there, and Jesus says, listen, ready? Don't, you know, listen. He got this sidetracked with that woman, you know, and they came and said, look, your daughter's dead. He said, listen, don't you buy into that. Don't you listen. You just believe. I told you I'm going to heal your daughter. Now, trust me. Trust me. I told you. I gave you the word of God. You can trust the word of God. Just, I'm told you that. And then he went in there and he said, listen, everybody else, y'all stay here. All them multitudes, other disciples, y'all handle the crowd. Peter, James, and John, come on, I've got to get the right team built around me. And now he's stepping into this situation. Here we go, ready? In verse 38, when they came to the home of the synagogue leader, it was Jairus, Jesus saw a commotion. Say commotion. See, that's energy without doing anything. That's like sideways energy. Y'all ever had any sideways energy in your life? You're doing stuff, but it ain't doing nothing. Sideways energy. Commotion with people crying and wailing loudly, just crying and wailing, just real negative atmosphere, not positive at all. He went in and said to them, why all this commotion and wailing? The child's not dead.
but asleep. Now, he's taken this negative, wailing, depressing atmosphere, and now he's injected faith into this atmosphere, and look at what they did. But they laughed at him. They laughed at him. He injected faith, and now they've laughed at him. And I love this next part. And it goes, and after he put them all out, right? Now you got to love that, right? He said, "Hey," he comes in. He said, "Hey, why y'all? You know, why y'all crying? This girl's not dead." And they just laughed at him. Then he just said, "Okay, well, here you go. Y'all all get out of here." I want to do that sometimes. Y'all ever want to do that, right? He said, "Listen, here's what best thing. Just leave. I just want you to leave right now, right? That's what you can do." After he put them all out, he took the child's father and mother and the disciples, which is Peter, James, and John. So now he's got five people with him, you know, just a small little group who were with him and went where the child was. Now here you go. Ready? There was wailing, a lot of negativity. You ever been in an environment where there's a lot of wailing? How many of you have ever been in an environment where there's a lot of negativity? Hold your hands up, right? Because see, ready? Watch this. Every Charlie Brown has to have a Lucy. Who's always down, always, we can't, every poo has to have a Eeyore. I love his, bless him, but Lord have mercy, he's negative, right? Everybody's got to have somebody who's just negative. And so you got to go into an environment and you got to quit. He said, "Listen, I'm going to change the environment." And then not only were they negative, but then whenever you inject faith, they start laughing at you. You know anybody like that? Some of you from a family like that, that's very negative. And then whenever you inject faith into that family, they're like, "Oh, so you're going to be a Bible person. You're going to try to go back to school, aren't you? You're going to be a tither, givey, goody, goody, two shoes. And you're not going to do this no more. And our family's always." You see, here's the deal. Ready? You've got to change the atmosphere if you're going to have a revival. If you're going to have something good in your life, you're going to have to change the atmosphere. You're going to have to... Some of you are going to have to put some people out. Did y'all know that? You're going to have to put some people out of your life. You're going to have to put some space between you and some people. I'm going to talk about that in the next series. You're going to have to stop. Some of you are going to have to stop wailing. Some of you have been crying long enough. I hate your marriage is over. I really do. But how long are you going to sit there? I mean, you can't be negative but so long, right? Some of you are going to have to quit crying. Some of you are going to have to quit laughing. Some of you have not been taking the things of God serious. You've been laughing under your breath. You cannot have a move of God in your life if you're not taking your faith serious. Come on, y'all understanding that? If so, say amen. And then what you've got to do is you've got to change the atmosphere of your life, because atmosphere will either encourage the move of God or it will kill the move of God. For instance, watch this. Ready? Have you ever noticed that when I get to this part of the service, and maybe I guess those that are online can hear this too, that we have a musician come up, and have you ever noticed how the tone changes? Have y'all noticed? If so, nod at me. Y'all ever seen that? Like right now, just me talking. Don't you just feel God as Pastor Mike is playing softly? Don't you? I can just say, you need to go home and wash your dishes. And you need to scrub them for the glory of God. And like, don't you just want to get saved right now? Just, you know, right now. But watch this. Go ahead, go ahead, kill it right here, Mike, Pastor Mike. You need to go home and wash your dishes. Now you're mad, right? Right now you're mad. But now watch this. Go ahead. Boy. Don't y'all just feel the move of God right now, right? It's like when he begins to play, it's like the Holy Spirit came in the room right there, right? Because see, music has that power, right? Because it changes the atmosphere. You know, the first time I ever told a girl I loved her, it was on prom night. I didn't love her. But you know why I told her I loved her? I had Lionel Richie over there tickling the keys, you know, right? Made me say something stupid, you know, right? But see, here's the deal. Watch this. What I'm trying to say here, and I'm having way too much fun in this sermon. I've been
I've been gone all week. I've been gone to out of town, and so I just, I've been a little crazy, I guess. But anyway, here you go, ready? Here's the deal. If you want to see the move of God, you're going to have to do what music does into his church. You've got to change the atmosphere. Because, see, your flesh is too strong. You will not naturally stay on the road of life. Come on, anybody know that? Y'all live long enough to know that? You're going to have to change the atmosphere, just like whenever he starts playing at the end of this song, and I'm reading, and I'm preaching, and you're in this environment. You're like, I commit, I promise, I'm going to tithe, I'm going to go to the altar, I'm going to get saved, I'm going to work on this marriage, and you're just, right? But watch this. You walk out of here, and go ahead, the music stops. And your youngin's crying, and you got homework to do when you get home. And now you got to decide what you're going to do. Come on, anybody with me? So what we got to do is change the atmosphere. We got to change the atmosphere. You're going to have to create some disciplines in your life. You say, well, Dad, what am I talking about? Watch this. Let me give you, because I want to make this real practical, and I got to end this message, and we got to pray. Watch this. Here, let me make this practical. You need to start your day reading your Bible and praying every single day. It'll change. Write it down. Write that down. Start your day. If it's nothing but one verse, one chapter, you start your day reading the Bible, it will reboot you spiritually. Just start your day reading God's word and praying. Write this one down. Do a trial. For 30 days, listen to nothing but K-Love or 107.3, and I know some of you come from different areas, so I don't know the station, but find a contemporary Christian radio station, and for 30 days listen to nothing but contemporary Christian music like we sing here. You'll find something changing in you. Has anybody ever done that? If so, say amen. If you notice that, you'll notice an atmosphere change inside of you, and all of a sudden you start being here. Here's what you need to do. You need to join a small group. We're going to have a summer semester small group. Join a small group and get some new people in your life that have a positive attitude. Begin to serve. You need to start making some decisions to change the atmosphere in your life that's going to speak life and not death. How many of you understand that? Hold your hands up good and high if you understand that. I'm thrilled. Here's what he did. He said he took her by the hand and said to her, whatever that is, I'm not even going to try with my North Carolina accent, which means, little girl, I say to you, get up. And then one of my favorite parts, immediately the girl stood up and began to walk around. Somebody say amen. Come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise for that. Amen. And it says she was 12 years old. And at this, they were completely astonished. Who wouldn't be? Ready? And I like this passage too. And he gave strict orders not to let anyone know about this. And I don't know why. Jesus is still trying to tell everybody. He's still trying to keep it a secret, but the multitude's there. But anyway, I don't fully understand why he did that. But here's the other part. And he told them to give her something to eat. Somebody say hallelujah right there, right? That's why we eat a lot around here, right there. Speaks life, when you eat, that's speaking life, man. That's building life, that's fueling life. And so he said, we're going to feed this, man. This is good. So here's what he discouraged the doubt, encouraged the faith. He built the right team. He built the right people around him. And then he separated himself from the negative environment. He kicked all those wailing and all those laughing out. And now he created an atmosphere. And what he saw is the move of God, because you've got to have the right atmosphere to have the move of God. And see, let me tell you some, in fact, you still taking notes ready? I'm going to give you some things that will kill an atmosphere. I jot them down. I ain't got time to preach them because y'all listen too slow in this sermon. But here we go. Ready? Here's some things. I jotted them down. I've got them right here on my notes. Ready? Here's some things that will kill the move of God in your life. Habitual sin. I'm not talking about a sin that you mess. Everybody, he without sin casts the first stone. But when you have a pattern of that sin, it will kill the move of God in your life. Here's another one. Ready? Drama and gossip. If you love that, you will kill the move of God in your life, because he cannot be where you're all wrapped up in that. That'll take your attention in places you don't need it to go. It'll be a negative place. Come on, I'm preaching right now. Here we go, ready? Here's another one, fear. If you just let fear dominate your life, it will kill the move of God, because you cannot have fear and faith in the same place if fear's driving the train. Now, you can have the emotion of fear, but you can't have fear in the engine seat. Here's another one. Ready? Commotion. They had a lot of commotion where you have, and this is, man, if I had time to preach it, that's what I'd say to everybody in our church family. A lot of sideways energy. Y'all are busy, but you're busy doing the wrong things. And they're not speaking life into your family. Commotion. Too much commotion. too much commotion. Here's another one. Ready? One more. I'll give you one more, and then we're gonna wind it down. Disbelief. You just don't believe it. Just don't buy into it. It'll kill a move of God in your life. Now, as a church, we have always wanted to be an environment that speaks life. We have worked hard to keep our leaders with the right attitude. We'll remove people for negative attitude. We've been called dictators, been called whatever, but you know what? You know why we laugh so much in our services? Because the Bible says laughter is good. It's like a medicine. And a cheerful heart is a powerful thing. And I want you to feel uplifted when you come to church here. You know why we have upbeat music and why we do the things we do? It's because I want you to go out. I want you to feel something. We want to be life-giving. You know why? I go to churches and speak, and they'll have like dinners and stuff, and they charge people for the food, and that's fine. We don't. You know why we don't? Because we want to be life-giving. You know why we give you things? Because we want you to have life. In fact, our vision is to reach Lee County and beyond. And so now we have gone outside of our county, and now we're in Harnett County at Life Springs, and we hope to plant other campuses. And so one of the topics that is on here, so everybody don't get excited about this, ready? But we realize that, you know, San Lee Chapel don't make sense outside of Lee County. Y'all know that, right? The name San Lee just don't make sense outside of Sanford. And so we recognize that our name is probably going to need to change. The bigger this church gets and the more we get outside of this walls, I don't know when or whatever, we just recognize it is. So we're having dialogues like, well, what will we change our name to? And you know what everybody's saying? It's got to say something about life. Maybe Life Springs. That's as good a name as any. If you have a better one, let's not. But you know why? It's got to say something about life, because that's what our church is about. Have y'all noticed that? If so, say amen, right? We just want to breathe life into people, because I think there's too many marriages that are dead that God wants to resurrect. I think there's too many people that feel dead inside that God wants to resurrect, and we just want to speak life. I speak life over your family. I speak life over your finances. I speak life over your emotions. I speak life over your sanity. I want you to have life and have it to the full, because that's why Jesus came. Is everybody with me? If so, say amen. So here's how I want to end this sermon series, and I want you to all stand in here, and I want you to stand at Life Springs, and I want you to stand in the lounge, and I'm gonna pray a blessing over you. I want to bless you, and then we're gonna sing. And I just want to pray blessing over you. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, how many of you would say, Dale, I'm not sure I'm on the right road in life, but I want to pray a prayer of commitment. I want to ask God to save me. I want to get on the right road. Hold your hands up good and high. Good night. If that's you, yeah, I see hands. Yeah, that's cool. That's cool. Here we go. Ready? I don't know. Life Springs in the lounge right here. If you raised your hand, keep them up and just close your eyes. And here's what I want you to say. God, I don't know if I'm on the right road, but I want to get on the right road. Forgive me of my sins. Forgive me of my sins. From this point forward, I want to do life with you. I want you to guide me. I want you to make my decisions. I want you to help me get on the right road. In the name of Jesus. If you prayed that prayer, welcome to the kingdom of God. You're just as much a Christian as I am or anybody else is. I want you to get your prayer card right now, and I want you to check the box that says, I just began or re-began a relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, here you go. Ready? How many of you want life over every area? You want the abundant life Jesus has promised you. Hold your hands up good and high. Keep them up. Keep them up. Hold your hands. If you're with your spouse or a boyfriend or fiance, hold hands with them right now. Ready? Just if you want the abundant life Jesus has promised you, keep your hand up right now. I'm going to pray a blessing. I want you to see that. You want life. You want the life God has promised. Father, for every hand raised, I speak blessings. I speak blessings over them spiritually right now. Let there be a connection made with you they never knew they had. I speak blessings over them spiritually. Right now, I speak blessings over them emotionally. I pray that they would sense this joy that is indescribable, your word talks about, and that they would have a peace that goes beyond anything they can understand. I speak life over their emotions right now. I speak life over them physically, that they would not be plagued with disease and accident and harm, and them and their kids would be free from that, and that they would have a healthy life, that they would manage their health, they would steward their health, that they'd make good decisions with their health, and that they wouldn't be plagued to whatever that's plaguing them, that's the diabetes or the over high blood pressure, the overeating or addicted to cigarettes or alcohol or whatever, but that they would have a physical health that would be there. I pray for them financially. I speak life over their finances, that as they give, that they would be inviting you into their finances, and then you would bless them and you would let them
them see your blessings in an incredible way. I speak blessings over their kids right now, that their kids would walk in the fullness of the gospel and that they would not make the same dumb decisions we made, but that they would walk. God, I pray that they would have life. I pray that that life would be who our church is about, and that you would let this be Life Springs, that it would spring forth life. When people drive on this property, they would begin to walk into that life and they would sense you and feel you, God, in an incredible way as we see you moving in our life. And we receive it in the name of Jesus. Would you right now say, I receive it in the name of Jesus. Ready? I receive it in the name of, come on, a little louder. I receive it in the, hey, you reach up and like you're taking hold of it. Ready? I receive it in the name of Jesus. A little louder. I receive it in the name of Jesus. Let's give God a hand clap of praise right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.